Claudio, sorry, Professor Lo Sterzo, I'd like to thank with you all the organizers for this opportunity to share with you some new data, if I'm able to do that, on how these lipid signals can impact on neurotransmission and then food intake. So I'm trying to open my screen. Let's see if I can manage. Maybe not. Maybe yes. Let's see. Sorry for this, but I'm used to another platform that works differently. Okay, no way. Present now. Well, do you see my screen? Hopefully you do.
Yes, it's okay.
Yes.
Thanks. Perfect. Okay, let's move. So, you see, what I would like to share with you is a number of points that, of course, I hope to be able to deliver you in a smooth way, because the field is actually huge, and in a way, it follows on with what Mauro was saying, that we need to remember external modulators when we want to compare them with the internal reactions, because there are also internal counterparts of external molecules. And the two things, from the outside and the inside, they seem to work together. So I would like to briefly remind what the external compounds that I'm talking about are, the phytocannabinoids, what the internal system that reacts to them is made of, the endocannabinoid system, and how the endogenous compounds can play a major role in neurotransmission and then in food intake. Always keeping in mind that if we understand properly how the internal molecules, the endogenous molecules work, we can finally take advantage also of some of the exogenous compounds to exploit them as therapeutics, but even in a kind of food version that is not yet fully explored. So just to keep a certain agenda and the flow in the lecture, I want to remind that we know that for centuries, herbal cannabis has been used by humankind for many purposes. But already in the second century, in China, people recognized some pharmacological properties to this extract. And it took a couple of thousand of years to end up with the main reason why plant extracts could be effective on our body. And the reason was one single molecule that Mechoulam identified in 1964 as delta-9 tetrahydrocannabinol on the left of the screen, and that allowed a new field of investigation to understand why a plant compound that we cannot synthesize was so active, even therapeutically effective on our body. This led in a few years to the discovery of endogenous compounds that all of us have, and these are made of a lipid, an arachidonic acid. So they are lipids called anandamide, a word coming from the Sanskrit and meaning inner bliss. It is actually a derivative of arachidonic acid bound to an ethanolamine in the middle, and then another one that is an ester of glycerol, again with arachidonic acid. So we do have endogenous molecules that can do what THC does, if you want, by accident. I also have to remind now that, in fact, plant extracts do not simply contain THC, but they do have a bunch of molecules that we call altogether phytocannabinoids, at least 112, plus more than 440 compounds that are not phytocannabinoids. And it is indeed this richness in components that makes the use of cannabis a little bit puzzling and potentially beneficial, but also potentially toxic, to an extent that we know that many of the other components of plant extract, so other meaning other than THC, can have specific effects on our body. You see in this slide, the effects are quite a number, but the slide is old. It comes from my colleague and friend Angelo Izzo from 2009. Now we know that there are many more entries that we should add to this picture. So it is a complex system able to activate from skin-related disorders like psoriasis to analgesic effect to bone stimulant, so really many. And we have to remember that even a different strain in cannabis, so a cannabis sativa versus a cannabis, or even a different way you grow the same plant, can lead to a chemical composition that is totally different. So that we call chemovars, the different cultivars of the cannabis. And again, even the same chemovar, the same strain can give different chemovars depending on the growth condition. So we have a very high complexity in the plant extracts, and we have to take care of them because this is the reason why cannabis still represents a global health priority and is still considered a gateway drug, so something that is able to lead the consumer to look for heavier drugs in his life. On the other hand, cannabis extracts are also a great promise for therapy, to such an extent that you see that people are still hoping to get from cannabis a pill and to use the active principles of cannabis in a positive way. But the problem is that each of those components, and in this slide I only listed the main ones like cannabidiol, cannabidivarin, cannabigerol, but of course I don't want to go into any detail on this, but each of the major components actually finds many cellular targets in our body. And this allows me to move from the exogenous compounds to the endogenous system, whereby this endocannabinoid system, as it is called, is actually a target for THC, but also for the endogenous molecules. By the way, some of you may have wondered, how is it possible that a tetrahydrocannabinol, a terpenophenol compound, can do the same things as an anandamide that is, as I said, a derivative of arachidonic acid. And here you see an answer. When you look at the three-dimensional structures of phytocannabinoids and endocannabinoids, and you put them in the context of where they really work, you see that they share three portions, so-called pharmacophores, that allow them to find exactly the same targets and trigger similar responses. So nature sometimes makes jokes with chemistry, so structures on paper are not as they are in real life. But again, we have a complex endogenous system able to synthesize the endogenous compounds. Please note that, again, we cannot make THC, we cannot synthesize phytocannabinoids, and we cannot even destroy them, clip them, which poses problems in the duration of phytocannabinoids when we assume that from the outside. But this, of course, is a little bit beyond the topic of this talk. Endocannabinoids instead are controlled by a tight metabolic regulation whereby a number of biosynthetic enzymes on top of this slide and a number of hydrolytic enzymes on the lower part can control the amount, the concentration of the endocannabinoids, and therefore their ability to activate a number of targets in the middle of the slide, like type 1 and type 2 cannabinoid receptors, CB1 and CB2, and others. And if I share with you the next slide, you might share the feeling complexity that the system, the endocannabinoid system, has, because it is not only a matter of a number of receptors, a number of enzymes, biosynthetic and hydrolytic, a number of transporters, extracellular and intracellular, but it is also a matter of location of these different targets and intracellular trafficking of them, which is particularly relevant when we think of the activities of the endocannabinoids. And first of all, I can remind you and myself that at the periphery, endocannabinoids do many things, especially for the topic of today, in the gastrointestinal tract, where they clearly inhibit intestinal motility, but also in related systems like the immune system that was also touched upon in the previous lecture, where they control, severely control inflammation and metabolism with a number of metabolic effects, and I will go to that in a minute, and cardiovascular system where at least the vasodilation is under control. But we are also very much interested in what they do in the central nervous system. So how endocannabinoid signaling can control neurotransmission. And here we have at least two major peculiarities of the endocannabinoids. The first one is shown on the left of the slide, where you can simply appreciate how one endocannabinoid, anandamide, is produced in the presynaptic neuron to activate receptors on the postsynaptic neuron. And this is quite a classical way a neurotransmitter work. But surprisingly, the other endocannabinoid, 2AG, is instead produced postsynaptically to activate receptors presynaptically, what is called retrograde signaling, a rather unique feature that endocannabinoids have. And this has many implications, because if you see on the other part of the slide on the right, you can understand that not only the cannabinoid receptors and receptors that are within the endocannabinoid system, like the vanilloid receptor, TRPV1, are of course activated, but also other receptors like glutamate receptors, the AMPA receptors, GABA receptors, GABA-A, and even interleukin-1 beta and TNF receptors. So a plethora of targets that, depending on the context, for instance, a different neuroinflammatory diseases, can clearly contribute to the way neurons talk to each other. So we have to think of endocannabinoids not only as neurotransmitters via retrograde signaling, unique feature, but also as neuromodulators of many other neurotransmitters that we know. And it is not surprising that within the central nervous system, especially through a type 1 cannabinoid receptor, endocannabinoids exert a number of effects. And here I just go through the different consequences of activation of different areas of the brain, just to highlight that also food intake, both via an increased appetite and via anti-emetic activities, are known among the main actions of endocannabinoids for a long time. And how does it go to the to food intake? Well, first of all, it has been shown years ago and nicely summarized by my colleague and friend Keith Sharkey that the entire gastrointestinal tract has elements of the endocannabinoid system at a different location. Here you see in the myenteric plexus, you have type 1 and type 2 cannabinoid receptors, in the submucosal plexus as well, but also then in the villi, you see elements of the system that are also present in immune cells and enteroendocrine cells, altogether controlling motility, as I said before, but also inflammation at this level, permeability of this of the villi to nutrients, and a number of other activities of the GI. And this is extended also to a central control of nausea and vomiting via activity in the visceral insular cortex, where endocannabinoids like 2-AG, again in a retrograde manner, can control the release of 5-hydroxytryptamine and therefore the activation of these serotonin receptors, especially type 3, with a direct effect on emesis. And more recently, a clear effect has been recognized to these lipid signals in merging the intestine and the brain, the very well-known axis that connects the two, by also when there is a chronic stress, the consequence of which is, for instance, an increase in 2-AG and the anandamide by a decrease of the their degradation by far, and an increase in specific target receptors like the vanilloid receptors, TRPV1, at the expenses of the type 1 cannabinoid receptor. So, apart from the details, a clear imbalance of endocannabinoid signaling that drives these signals to a receptor, the vanilloid receptor, very much involved in inflammation. So, it is not surprising that also very specific activities of endocannabinoids on food intake have been recognized and have been shown to be mediated by CB1, both centrally, again, an increase in food intake, but also peripherally at the adipose tissue level, at the liver level, pancreas, and muscles. Maybe some of you will remember that indeed, for a few years, hopes were that blocking CB1 with a specific drug called rimonabant was a real hope, a promise to control obesity. And on the other hand, also blocking the degradation of the endogenous cannabinoids by blocking the main hydrolase, the FAAH via URB, was also a possible alternative to reach the same result. The problem was that rimonabant was indeed effective in controlling obesity, but was also active in many other places of the body where CB1 receptors are located, and side effects were so severe that rimonabant was withdrawn from the market. But the proof of concept is there. You can control just one element of the endocannabinoid system, like one receptor, to control the ability of the energy homeostasis in our body, controlling weight, controlling the amount of triglycerides, controlling the transport of cholesterol, potentially with very, very positive effects on our body. So now people are working to make a CB1 antagonist like rimonabant more selective and, first of all, unable to cross the blood-brain barrier to avoid central effects. It is then interesting that not only synthetic compounds like rimonabant and the URB597 can be used to manipulate the endogenous cannabinoid system, but also natural compounds, of course, the cannabinoids, the phytocannabinoids that also act on the different elements of the endocannabinoid system, as I showed you before, but also others present in food, like the beta-caryophyllene, the very first on top of this slide, that has promising results as a modulator of CB1 and CB2. So we might find in food components, ingredients that can control a signaling system of which we know, we start to understand the very fine regulation of food intake. And indeed, these lipids, these endocannabinoids, have been recognized also as drivers of hedonic eating, where you have what we call the delicious cycle that can lead through these lipid mediators to regulate dopamine neurotransmission. Here we have just a scheme to see how the lateral hypothalamus on top, nucleus accumbens on the left, the bottom left, and ventral tegmental area on the bottom right, can share signals via endocannabinoids, and also in through these lipids can modulate the activity of well-known messengers for food intake like orexin, leptin, and ghrelin. So it is indeed a nicely complex scenario that can even reach the food addiction, can be the basis of compulsive eating and obsessive relation with an excessive consumption of food. In this nice review that we could write years ago, a few years ago, with Professor Daddario, we could show how indeed many data in the literature speak in favor of a major role of endocannabinoids in controlling food intake. For instance, here you see how just the activation or the blockade, even either pharmacological or genetic of CB1 can have impact on the melanocortin system, on the leptin system, on the CCK system, and others. Overall, stressing how strict is the relation between signals that have to do with it, with food intake, and how diet per se can control endocannabinoid levels and endocannabinoid signaling. And you see here again, it's just to share with you the complexity on one side, but also the number of data that we have been to we have been able to collect so far on the other, just to say how much the link between diet and endocannabinoids has been already demonstrated in the literature. And this is has also a very nice implication in the fact that food can be a disease modifier. This is very well recognized in the literature, and it is some time that this goes. But we added the fact that it can be a disease modifier through endocannabinoid signaling. And this is interesting because many of the disease modifier activities of food have to go through epigenetic modifications. And again, with Claudio Daddario, we happen to show how the major tools that epigenetic regulation uses for controlling gene expression, like DNA methylation or histone modifications, or the use of non-coding RNA to open or close up, open up or close a certain gene, well, all of them are indeed under control, at least partial control, of endocannabinoid signaling. And this leads me to the last slide, where we thought to put all this background information together, and also in the context of inflammation. And I'm glad that the previous speaker touched upon this also for antioxidant, for the redox balance, let's say. Because what we would like to explore in what is called a mild action is how mood could be modulated by inflammatory signals via lipids and diet, putting together how the immune system, the neuron transmission, and the role that lipids, I would say endocannabinoids first, but I could also add now new lipids that are able to resolve inflammation, avoiding that a good thing, like an inflammatory response, becomes a bad thing, so a chronic inflammation, and these new lipids are called resolvins. How these all together can help, can control the mood, and how a balanced diet can help to avoid mood alterations that can lead even to psychosis. So with this, I thank you for your attention, and I'd like to thank again the organizers and the team in Teramo that had in the last years, and certainly will have in the future, a key role in all these investigations that we have also been able to do on lipid signaling and food intake. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Mauro, for your very interesting presentation. And now we have time for a few questions, and those who have questions can turn on the microphone. But... I think Aldo has a first question.
Hello, Mauro.
Ciao, Aldo.
Good morning. Good morning. Congratulations for your nice presentation. So I have a question for you about the possible relationships among microbiota and endocannabinoid systems. You stated that gastrointestinal system is rich in receptor from the endocannabinoid system. So you know we host a billion or trillions of microorganisms, and with food also we ingest many microorganisms, for example with fermented foods or functional foods. Can you tell us something about these possible relationships by microbiota or their metabolites with the, for example, short chain fatty acids with this system? Thank you.
So thank you, Aldo. This is very interesting question. It is actually one of the frontier fields of investigation for the lipid signals. I can tell you that there are certainly effects of endocannabinoids on the microbiota, in particular in the context of mood alterations that are depending on what you eat, so on food intake. And a colleague of mine, Ms. Patrice Cani, who is with John Cryan, that I like to greet if he's already connected, but together with John are members of this mild action, because we believe that we have to investigate further the specific point of actions. So what they found is that the specific microbe, the Akkermansia, is very critical also to the extent of leading to pathologies. And the way it does seem to be very much dependent on these lipid signals. So It is really a very, very major field of investigation. There are already there is already evidence of the role of this signaling, but much more is being doing, let's say. And hopefully we can contribute also with Teramo to get some new results.
Thank you, Mauro. Thank you.
Thank you.
There is any question from the audience?
Claudio,
okay, we have a question by Enrico Dainese. So,
hola.
Thank you, Mauro, for the fascinating talk. Ciao, Mauro.
Ciao, Enrico.
I'm pleased that you are here with us. And of course, you know, you mentioned various effects, the complex of the complex effects on the endocannabinoid system. Actually, we know very well that, you know, also the anti-inflammatory property of this endocannabinoid system is very important, and also the interplay with lipoxygenase and cyclooxygenase systems is another very crucial aspect of this story. Could you tell us a little bit more about that, please?
Thank you. Thank you, Enrico, for this also very interesting question. Coming from an expert on lipoxygenesis, it is even more appreciated. You know, there is an entire part of endocannabinoid metabolism that has been under-investigated. That is not the degradation of them, but the biotransformation. So I mean that some lipoxygenases and one cyclooxygenase 2, the inducible one, the smart one, are able to add molecular oxygen to endocannabinoids. And the interesting thing is that the products that come from that have biological activities different from properties of endocannabinoids. So oxygenated endocannabinoids are new bioactive molecules, and it is we do not know much about that. I hope that we find ways to further explore how blockade of lipoxygenase in immune cells can impact on the production of inflammatory signals. And the same could be done with modulation of COX-2. So, a huge field again that, especially for the interaction of with microbes, like Aldo was asking before, could have a role. Could certainly have a major role.
Okay. If that was yes, if I don't know if I can do a question, if it's possible. Hey. Ciao Mauro, Carlo Cipani from University of Camerino. Congratulations for a very interesting presentation. You showed involvement of the endocannabinoid system in food addiction. Maybe we can just show specific alteration in eating disorder, like, I don't know, binge eating, anorexia nervosa, all these results. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Carlo. And again, it's a pleasure to have the question from one of the masters in the field. And therefore, you know that there are many, many data from many different models, even alcohol-preferring rodents, showing that each eating disorder has specific traits when you look at alteration of the endocannabinoid system. So this is, from one side, challenging, from the other one, kind of scaring, because the system is so complex indeed that to dissect a specific change that can then mark that specific eating disorder is still an open issue. So I would say, I think that maybe it is safe to say, certainly we are disclosing molecular events that are behind the different eating disorders and the impact on the endocannabinoid system. But maybe we have not yet really understood what is specific of what. And this, I think, is a challenge that deserves to be taken, also because you might get find out biomarkers of a certain eating disorders before the clinical symptoms are apparent. So I hope I could reply to your question with this.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mauro. It's always a pleasure to listen to you and also to collaborate with you.